Right, gentlemen. I'm going to be talking about an issue that has been hitting the papers lately. A lot of people would have read about it, right? Aadhar. That is it good, bad, and it's all over the media that our fingerprints, our privacy breaches are going to happen, right? So, briefly, of what I'm going to discuss in this presentation and what I'm going to not discuss. So let me tell you what I'm not going to discuss. I will not examine Aadhar security here. We are not going to discuss about that. That's an entirely different subject. And just to set your mind at rest, it is pretty secure. If I want to summarize in one word, the UAID data center is quite secure. No worries there. So this is all hype getting created here. I'm going to talk about an entirely different subject, which is philosophy of fingerprints in general for authentication, right? With a case study on Aadhar Pay. I'm sorry, Giri, I'll have to ask for your help here. Right click is this, right? Yes, thank you. Okay, gentlemen, a quick summary of how Aadhar Pay works, right? No, I'm just trying to see, and it's not working. Okay, it's not visible on that. No problem. The way the Aadhar Pay works is, I mean, this is the next big thing that's coming apart from the UPI payments, right? Then, of course, your PTMs, etc. You have Aadhar Pay, where, you know, the government envisages that everybody in our country will use, I think, fingerprint, and thereafter, you know, payments can happen. So how does this work? Number one, merchants. They'll be the guys, your Kirana store guys, right? They'll have to register themselves for Aadhaar-based payments, bank account given there. They'll have to install a fingerprint reader onto a smartphone or on a authorized point-of-sale terminal with a fingerprint reader attached to it. The fingerprint sensors will be certified by the government, right? I'll come over that in detail because this is basically the heart of my talk today. And third, the customer provides his fingerprint when he walks in there, wants to buy, let's take a liter of milk, puts his fingerprint for a transaction, his amount is debited because that's what gets flashed there onto the merchant's account and he walks away. Short and sweet, right? Okay, now let's go over it in a little bit detail. Fingerprints, generally speaking, you guys know what are the advantages, right? Which is why this thing is being touted as the next big thing for payments. You can't leave them at home. Everybody carries it around, right? Can't forget it like a smart card or something. You don't need a phone. Even a poor guy can do that, right? It's unique. Doesn't change over a lifetime. I'm not so sure about this because I've seen certain elderly guys, you know, fingerprint too, but you got 10 of them. So probably one of them is going to work, right? And they require physical access for forgery, right? I mean, you need to be close to the guy. You can't do it remotely, steal somebody's fingerprint, right? So these are the advantages, which is why it's being touted as the next big thing, because in our villages, right, rural areas, not everybody can get smart cards, and the distribution costs are too high, not everybody has a smartphone. Okay. Now let's see how this whole thing is going to play out, right? When you walk into a Aadhaar enabled store. So therefore, there are two kinds of devices that are so far used for all kinds of apps, right? Public and registered devices. So let's take, there's an app which is running on your smartphone. Thereafter, there is a fingerprint reader, which has got a software development kit, SDK, right? Because every hardware comes with a software development kit, and the apps, payment apps will be made by third parties. Which third parties? They can be AUAs, right? What's an AUA and what's an ASA? Anybody? Anybody understand what's an AUA and ASA? Okay, you see what the Aadhaar has done is, the UADI, they have declared that we will have Aadhaar service agencies, a number of them. Let's say, I think there are around 7 or 8 right now, like MTNL is one, then NPCI is another one. Service agency, they'll have leased line connectivity, direct, point to point. So we will, the UADI will not directly be reachable by anybody. There will be an ASA, a registered service agency, like, for example, NPCI, who will be having leased line connectivity to UADI. Thereafter, these ASAs will sublet out. They will be the ones through which all the other guys will connect to. For example, AUAs are Aadhaar user agencies. Examples of AUA, let's take banks, you know, who want to offer payments. Telcos, who want to offer eKYC, they're all AUAs. There's another concept of sub-AUA, which will have a relationship with the AUA. So now the way it works is, ASAs and AUAs will be registered with UADI. You will have a digital signature to identify yourself to UADI. Sub-UAs may not, right? So now, this is the broad, technique which is going to be followed for authentication to the AIDI. So there's going to be a POS or a smartphone going to talk to an AUA, which is further going to redirect it to the ASA and back to the UIDI data center, right? Now let's see a little bit details about how the authentication is going to happen here. Two kinds of devices are there, gentlemen, public and registered. And what does it mean? Exactly what it says. A public device is not registered. Whereas a registered device is registered. With whom? UIDI. By registered, it means that UIDI will recognize every one of these point of sale terminals. Right? Has it started happening now? Not yet. Sorry, anybody? I heard somebody say something. Cool. Registered devices has not yet started. There was a meeting, I think, a couple of weeks back where UIDI had called in Delhi, where this standards were given to all the fingerprint manufacturers, right, of how do you register your device. So before that, let me come to public devices. Now, the way it works is you have your fingerprint reader on the left, extreme left, okay? Thereafter, there's a SDK, which should be caused the moment you put your fingerprint there. The app on top, let's take, it may be an eKYC app. How many of you have seen the eKYC, let's take by Jio or by Airtel or Vodafone? A quick show of hands. Fantastic. You've seen that app? That app has not been made by the biometric thumbprint maker. The thumbprint devices are made by some companies called Morpho, Safran, right? They're different. They've got their own software, SDK, on the mobile phone. The app is made by the AUA. The way it works is, the moment you put your fingerprint there, the app, which is made by the AUA, running on the system, captures your template. Which template is it? That template basically is minutiae of your fingerprint, not necessarily the image, right? It can also capture the minutiae of your iris. Minutiae means the small ridges that you have of fingerprint, that's called a minutiae. It translates it into a series of binary digits. And then it feeds it onto the app. And the app thereafter responsible for hashing, encrypting. This PID stands for personal identity data. Your fingerprints, minutiae, the template, and send it on directly to UIDI, right? The app does this. Thereafter, once it comes to AU, the AU also puts a digital signature on it. That look, this has come from one of my devices. This is the way the public devices work. Now, what happened in this case that you read about in the papers? For example, those of you who have missed it, from July last year till around February this year, some 397 requests were made by just one user from Axis Bank, Suvidha, and eMudra. All of them were working through their Axis Bank's AUA. Suvidha and eMudra were working through it, right? And when they tried to find out how come 397 requests for just one guy, how many times was he doing his fingerprint authentication? They found that they were basically testing. The details are still not very clear, but that's what the statements have been given out in the paper, that eSuvidha guys, they said, we were testing on the production environment, right, of the UIDI. So again and again, they must have been trying. Now, here is why it happened, which I'm going to cover in the next few slides. What happened? What is the problem with this scenario, right? Why it is not fit for digital payments? Number one, fingerprints can be locally stored in this. How? Gentlemen, you will see a gap in this flow of fingerprint here. Anybody, where is the gap here? Between the SDK and the app, correct? The moment the app calls the SDK, it's in the what the comes out from there is in clear text. Clear text means it is not encrypted. Your fingerprints template minutiae comes out in clear. So what can happen? Anything can happen. You can store it. Right? You can put any timestamp on it. You can keep replaying it till kingdom come. And this is exactly what happened. Because this SDK, right, was sending it on a clear text, testers found it very convenient instead of putting it again and again to just read it off there and keep replaying it back again. Next, so therefore replay attacks. Right? You can manipulate just about anything. You can keep storing this thing forever. Anybody comes in with this kind of scenario, you can keep storing everybody's fingerprint locally. Possible. And lastly, recipient data and amount both can be altered. Why? The recipient data actually in the SDK, what comes out is not only a minutiae, it's some other stuff also. You can put your name also there, that kind of a thing. But you can just about alter anything here, right? So big problem here. Now this is why the payments thing has been now come to a halt. Axis Bank's thing has been stopped. And they are now, the latest thing is that for payments, UIDAI is going to use only registered devices, right? Which is my next thing. You see the difference between a registered device and a public device? See this one? See the blue arrow of hashing encryption? And see the encryption now. Where is it coming from? That's the difference. So now what UIDAI has mandated is, they will not leave it to the AUA to make sure that the fingerprint is encrypted. The device manufacturer himself has to make sure that the moment you put your thumb there, what comes out of there is only a hash, encrypted using a key which is shared between who? The device maker and UIDAI. It is an end-to-end encrypted hash. Got it? So there's a shared secret between UIDAI and the device. And there's a timestamp also which goes into it. There is a key also that goes along with it, shared into it. So therefore, now if you try to manipulate it, right, the hash will change, so you can't do that. If you try to locally store it, it's pointless to you, it's encrypted hash. If you try to replay it, what will happen? Timestamp is there. There's a unique transaction ID is also there, and there's a device identity is also there. So they've come out with two kind of avatars to handle this. Number one, make sure that the SDK is certified, right, by UIDAI. And second, try to make these devices with a hardware security module on it. What is an example of a hardware security module that you see most commonly? Anybody? Where you swipe your debit card. You see the POS terminals? It's got a hardware security module in it, right? Okay. So now you see that with the registered device, storage is not possible. Replays are also not possible. Only registered devices can be used, so therefore, no. So replay attack, transaction timestamp is there, every request is hash, right? Duplicate check at UIDAI. Are they doing it? No, unfortunately not. Somehow, maybe they'll do it sometime, because you see the problem with the duplicate check. What is stopping me from replaying fingerprint again and again? What will UIDAI have to do? They'll have to maintain state. When was it that me, Brijesh Datta, put his fingerprint the first time, right? Second time, did the identical template down to the last binary bit come back again within 12 hours, within 6 hours? Imagine how long will they have to store it for every authentication request. So right now, I think because of technical limitations, there is no check on whether a duplicate template down to the last bit is getting replayed. Unfortunately, it is not there. But because of this other things that they are doing, most likely the misuse are not going to happen there. Recipient data amount can be altered, so since this is digitally signed, at the very end, nothing can happen, right? And of course, there's an audit also going on. Every one of the AUS, by the way, the apps are going to get audited now through a third party, STQC or certain registered provider, auditor. All right. So this was about in general. Now, I got 20 minutes, gentlemen, so I'm going to give you only the key points of fingerprints, right? What is the generic issues that is problematic in this case? Even let's take... We made sure in this that the fingerprint goes as is, right? But how is this different from a debit card? Why is it that debit cards are used worldwide and people are not using fingerprints in this fashion? How are people using fingerprints for payments? There are generally two most common ones, right? Apple Pay, Samsung Pay. You must have heard of this, right? The way it works is, where does the fingerprint get stored on Apple Pay and Samsung Pay? Worldwide, they're the standards, right? Is it on a central authority? No, it's only on this phone. Your fingerprint unlocks the HSN, and therefore the encryption happens and the data goes out. Okay, so that's one difference. The second difference between a chip and your finger, right? You can take a debit card and go and put it in a POS. Okay, but with a finger, the key difference is the smart card is smart. It's got a small computer. You see the chip-based smart card? It's got a small computer on board. It can talk intelligently to the POS. It will not allow that POS machine, point of sale machine, to read any data from inside the smart card unless you provide the right key. Does your finger have everything, anything at all? No, it doesn't, right? So potentially one can put a fake device also, and you will not know any better. And your fingerprint image can be captured and thereafter translated, right? So one key thing about fingerprint is some number one, you leave it everywhere, common, right? You can put it on a CD. In fact, there was a case when they wanted to steal around 2 years back, there's a video on this. People wanted to steal their colleague's fingerprint, who promised them that there's no way you can steal my fingerprint. So they just gave him some CDs. Yeah. He held the CD in there and the fingerprint was there. Any glass top, they can be sealed. They can be forged, Fake finger. Can you please click on this? This URL called fake finger. Yeah. Gentlemen, this first article, gummy fingers, is dated 2002. We've come a long way from there. It's very easy to duplicate a fingerprint. You know, to create a cast of a fingerprint. This other one, Kiosk Computer Club, they broke an Apple Touch ID in 2013 itself. Just create a film around it, and you'll find plenty of articles on the internet of how exactly to forge a fingerprint. It is pretty elementary, right? The only thing that is safeguard in our case is that there is a guy who's standing there at the shop. So if you try to put a film around your finger, you can get caught, right? But unfortunately, if that guy is in cahoots with you, then there is a problem, right? If he's also a crook, right, and he gets hold of a AUM machine for some time, then a fraud can happen. Can you please click the back arrow? At the bottom, right. Blue arrow, yeah. Thank you. And the most important, gentlemen, what is the problem with a finger? Once it is compromised, you're gone. Right? What do? You can't change your fingerprint. This is the biggest showstopper, point number three. Why? You know, there is so much of hesitation in the security community to use fingerprints. So obviously, so one advantage is you got 10 of them. So let's take my thumb gets compromised somehow, and people in Bihar and UP have got my print. Maybe I can use my forefinger, right, on this thing. Well, it's endless thing. What will I, they'll run out of fingers very soon, right? Biggest issue. And lastly, I already told you that, you know, smart cards, obviously, they're smarter. And fingerprints are inherently weaker. So this was it, gentlemen. Short and quick note, I'll just show you one more thing. What can happen? What is the problem with the fingerprint-based Aadhaar, right? Inconvenience. This is nothing to do with security, but just a matter of interest to you. You either type in a 12-digit Aadhaar number at the merchant or your phone number. How many mistakes are likely to be made? Plenty, right? Trying to type it out. Next, you'll enter amount, a bank. You select a bank account because you may have your Aadhaar card linked with three more bank accounts, right? Thereafter, you will take a fingerprint. What is FRR? False rate, false registration rate, right? You can have a false registration, so you'll put it again and again. You, in case you guys have gone to an eKYC, you'll notice that very often that guy is busy cleaning his sensor. Doesn't work the first time, second time. I don't know how successful this is going to be considering the quality of our fingerprint sensors. And you see the photo on below? This can very well happen. So maybe there might be adoption problems. Maybe we'll get better at this. But this is generally